With me is also Michael Schröder on the top left. He works with me on the build service as well, beside others. So who of you have seen the build service? Who have checked it? Okay. But you all used Copper at least, or your build systems, and you do packaging. Or who is not doing packaging here in Novi? Okay. Okay, so I did not plan to talk again about build service itself, what it does, what features it has. I wanted more to discuss about how it's used today for development and how we can bring the daily development with build service together, because the view of the distribution and development is quite different from the view of a daily developer who works in his upstream code. First of all, a court status. Build service is old, meanwhile, boring old, so it's more than 7 years, or 7 years since we started it. Initially, it was just a very thin layer. It was just building add-on packages for distributions, but since beginning, not limited to SUSE. It supported since the beginning also Fedora, but also complete others distributions like Debian with complete different packaging formats. We developed it over time, and we replaced our old system called AutoBuild at some point of time. And for OpenSUSE these days, it is really doing everything. So when we launched OpenSUSE, there was still many things done behind closed doors in SUSE. Nowadays, really everything is open source, not only the distribution building, also the maintenance and stuff and everything, basically. And currently, the 2.5 beta is about to be released, or the beta is released, the 2.5 final will be soon. Most of the code changes there is SUSE Linux Enterprise maintenance support. So this is something which is most likely less interesting for you. But we integrated also other functionality like the notification system and the comment system, which makes it more easy and gives hopefully a bit more GitHub-like experience. So what you can see here is the code base of the build service itself, so not of the content, the build service itself. And the good thing is we added actually quite complex features with the enterprise stuff, but you see the number of lines of code actually did decrease in the last year. So it's a reason we did lots of refactoring, and we have the feeling that we are on a good way to make the code more mature and not yet another if case. We have many users. Besides SUSE, I think we have over 100 build service instances connecting to others and permanently. And then I'm aware of multiple instances which do not connect to us but working on their own in some company. And then there are companies who just come to us and work in our build service instance, and one of ours. We have multiple, but the only public one is a build OpenSUSE one. So the public OpenSUSE one, so this is the statistics of it. Currently, it is building more than 75,000 packages a day. So, of course, also caused by we offer free resources and people just write some scripts somewhere and just pushing stuff. So it can keep us busy. But so far we can deal with the load. We do regular cleanups and asking people kindly to delete something if it's not needed anymore. So in that way we can keep it in control. And quite some mirrors do not mirror everything anymore because it's too much for them. But the most important stuff is still mirrored quite well around the world. So it's the most interesting stuff is can be downloaded fast all over the world. And since it's an open project and many people ask for support, so there's of course a community support, and then there's a commercial support. The commercial support is in first place consulting work. Since SUSE does not offer that, we handed it out to one of our partners who is doing SUSE and also Red Hat stuff, B1 systems, and they have our backing, so if they have a problem, then they can ask us. But they offer support contracts for build service. Yeah, we are not limited to an architecture, so architectures really are easy to add. We need to write some code for a new architecture. The last one was a PowerPC little engine, but it's really done within minutes, I would say. Packaging formats, to support more packaging formats, it's more work, but we have quite some RPM and Debian from the beginning. Then a community member added the Arch Linux support to be able to package for Arch Linux. And then there are multiple ways of image creation inside of build service. So Pixie boot images, ISO images, VMware, and so on. And most important, at least for our public instance, is that it's used exclusively, in this instance, it uses exclusively secured VMs, because, I mean, building from source means already that you can execute random code. Okay, this is maybe not still as a user, but still you don't want to give the world network or a platform to reach out the network, so it must be sandboxed in any case. And since you can also install the build RPM for another RPM build, the users have basically root access. So we need desperately some kind of VM to secure the build. And yeah, beside KVM and Xen, there's some experimental support for ZVM on S390 and OpenStack and EC2, but really productive is KVM and Xen. One of the difference of build service compared to, let's say, GitHub also, is you can have branches, and we have lots of branches of any kinds of packages. With GitHub, you usually merge manually. The build service, of course, can you merge manually as well, but usually you expect that if you push, or when the base content is changing, that the build service is merging or trying to merge automatically and build you a new RPM so that you get immediately a result. Either it does not build anymore or a new RPM. So the build service is already some kind of tool on the way for continuous delivery, because you can upload sources, you get RPMs built, you get a repository, you get images automatically from it, without any additional work after the initial setup. So the continuous delivery is that what most people expect these days, but most people say actually continuous integration, which is a subset. So continuous integration was first defined last century, I forgot the exact date, and it first there were only the build bots. Then people decided, okay, it's nice that the stuff is building, but maybe it's also important that you can execute it at all. So then it was defined that there are all the test cases for the builds. Why do we do that? We want really to have a feedback as fast as possible. So who is doing continuous integration in some way in your project? Only a few. Yeah. So there is potential. So we want to have a constant quality assurance. We don't want to go a step back. And we want basically see before we merge something from someone else, whom we do not know maybe in the open source community. We want to know first if it still works and not afterwards. So if I merge it into my code, and afterwards everything breaks down, then it's usually my work to fix it, or I have to push the other guy hard. So it's way better to see it before I merge it, because it's way more motivating for the other guy to fix the stuff to get it merged. And in the end, only when we really have some minimal amount of test cases, we can actually refactor. So people who do not have test cases are very afraid to refactor their code, or they don't have direct contact with their users, maybe. But it's really important to clean up your code that you still know that you don't have regressions. And there's basically no way to have some kind of test cases. So what's actually the goal for each development cycle nowadays in most projects is that you include the delivery, but when you want to deliver, you need to test automated. When you automate to deliver, you can't deliver any, not something which is maybe eating your hard disk. And often the benchmark is mentioned because people fear that it's still working, but too slow system is still not acceptable for the users. So it's, especially in the web, it's most of the designs come from the web development side. So benchmarking is a critical issue there. What do we need for continuous integration? Simple thing, we need to have access to the sources. Luckily, we are in an open source world. This is really a small problem. It's usually the case, not everywhere else, but we don't have really much problems here. Also, the builds must not require that I click on some button. Luckily, we live with make files and stuff like that since years, or long time. Since the beginning, no problem for us. Test cases is something where we lack. So in the open source world, no one really has fun with test cases. It's way harder in the open source world to ask people to write test cases, in my experience. While in some commercial companies, it's often simply a requirement. And what's also very important is that it's not very helpful if you test something and it works there, but your production system looks quite different. What you want to do is, for testing, you want to test it in a system which is as near to production as possible. So what's examples which do exist and are used? Jenkins is the oldest and biggest example. I think everybody heard about Jenkins. It comes from the Java world, so it's a bit focused on Java, but it's not limited to Java. It's basically a nice web front end where you can define your jobs, you need to install your workers, and then it can pull automatically from Git, from SVN or whatever, the sources and runs the build. And gives you a nice overview. Disadvantage about Jenkins is that you have to maintain these workers. And yeah, when you have the next Fedora version and you want to test on the next Fedora version, then you need manually maintain a new worker for that. TravisCI.org is something which is tightly integrated with GitHub, and therefore it's quite often used. It's a free service for open source projects, at least. What's also nice is that they just grant you the resources, so they have the workers. You can just connect it to GitHub, to your GitHub repository, and it runs the test cases. And even nicer is that when you get a pull request from someone else, you could see if he breaks something. So it's a really cool thing. Problem is, it's not really an in-house option there, and you are limited to one certain Linux distribution we all do not like here. So I have no choice to test it on something else than this distribution. And if they upgrade the distribution, it suddenly breaks your test cases. So it's nice as a smoke test. It's not a final solution. So what can the OBS offer here? OBS is still focused on packaging, of course. So it's not the first choice developer tool when it comes to code development. But the advantage it has is that it sets up always a fresh system similar to mock when you build a package, and it's so easy just to add another target for it's just few lines of XML code in your project or a click button, mouse button in the web UI to add another Fedora, another Ubuntu, whatever target. And even better is you can reuse repositories from others. So you can also do tests like, okay, I know that the GCC people are working on the new compiler. Let's see what this breaks, and you can just build it in parallel. And this is just a mouse click, basically. Just and you can see the difference of the results. And it scales, of course, very good because we build a lot of packages. So how to do it with build service? First, you need always to get the sources in, the current sources. Simple things is write a bash script. That's what everybody can do. And it's most flexible one. The biggest disadvantage of that version is we don't like this option because when we want to have packages in the distribution, we don't want for each submission, we don't want to check if it's actually safe to run this script. Because of course you can get a submission which harms your system, which sends out your personal wallet or whatever. So it might be acceptable, but we don't like it, and it's more a personal hack than a good solution for collaborating on sources. So what we have is source services, therefore. That is some kinds of script, but which have a defined interface. And you can tell them, for example, to download from Git and make a tarball and update this back file. So the source services needs to run, and they still need to store a tarball, but they should be safe, so you shouldn't be able to craft the information that it harms your system, because the source service itself should be trustable. And after you did it the first time, you can give the build service always a trigger, now update again. Since you don't want to give it a trigger manually each time, so you want to push something to GitHub, and it should do it automatically, and so you don't want to be disturbed in your workflow. We have, since this year, a token system. So you can create a token which allows to execute a certain action in your name, for example, to update the sources. And this token can be uploaded to GitHub. In GitHub, you find an OBS option, and when you place the token there, then every time you push something to GitHub, it will update the source on build service, and you get anyway the automatically builds, because build service detects when sources are changing and triggers builds automatically, and also indirect builds. Now we come to testing. So what we have so far in the packaging world is this person check section. I asked around between the SUSE developers, and I was surprised that only a few people were aware that RPM has person check section. I mean, luckily some more people add some checks to the install section, but that's too late to ask now. but still, so it's a basic checking what you can do inside of a build of a package. Of course, it works only to some limit, within limits, and it only usually works when you have some kind of test case from upstream. I mean, I personally write sometimes also test cases of common mistakes with this package, so you can write, is this file really a symlink or not? But yeah, usually it's used for running test cases from upstream. And what you can do also nowadays already, when you want to have benchmarks and you run such a build and such a person checked, you can use the build service constraints. Constraints means are hardware constraints in first place, so where you can say, I need a system with 14 gigabytes of disk storage, or at least 4 CPUs, or for whatever reason, otherwise my package may fail. this mechanism can also be used to force a build on a certain host where we can be sure that the build times and run times are comparable. So that's what we do in some cases, not very often, just to use the build times as a measurement for the runtime of the code. Yeah, that's what I have. So now that's the current packaging what we do. Next step is to deliver it and so that systems can automatically use it. This direct delivery is very simple. So you can do, if you can't do the test within build service, you can also do it outside, and you can approve it by just releasing it. So you can have one repository, which is your development repository, and you can install from it. But if your QA department agrees to release this, you can press a button basically, and build service copies over the sources and the binaries without a rebuild, because QA department wouldn't accept it to rebuild it, to the other repository, and then it's available for the users. So a simple thing. Now we come to the points where we are not good enough, actually. So what we have at the moment for tests are the unit tests, as I said before. So you can add something to person check and to packages. We have packages which are testing multiple packages, other packages. So for instance, we have to test the LAMP stack, and this test case is just packaged in a known package which has a build requires to MySQL and Apache and PHP or whatever. And there can be functional tests. Functional tests are, for me, from a few of the build service, that you test really your entire product. So it's either the installation media we hand out or the appliances users use. OpenQA is a cool tool outside of build service. It basically runs through the installation. It detects what's on the screen, and it goes step by step through the installation and alarms us if something is breaking. I think Michael is having a lightning talk this evening, and he shows you the graphics and how to work with it, and it has some fancy graphics. It should be less text than my presentation. Problems with that, all that is, when you put something in person check, it increases the build time of the package, and this can become a problem, for instance, when you have a bootstrap cycle. So if you update the GCC or glibc and you bootstrap the basic cycle multiple times, you don't want to wait for the test cases each time. You first want to bootstrap and test afterwards. And another problem is currently if the only way to notify that the test cases are failing is to let the build fail. Otherwise, people won't notice it. But when the build is failing, you have also also throw away the build results, the RPM packages. So it's harder to test it, or you need to restart manually a local build to test to get the installation in the way that you can test and find out what exactly is actually wrong. So that are current problems. With the test packages I described before, with the LAMP package, so this is not connected. You have the build requires. So we know that it triggers the build when you change MySQL, for instance, but you have a package of MySQL, you only look at MySQL, and we have no way to see, actually, it breaks builds. So that's also missing. And we want to work on that. And external instances currently, like OpenQA, can't deliver test results back. So it's not our goal to have everything in build service, but we want to interconnect with other QA frameworks. So if you decide for any reason to use Jenkins, OpenQA or anything, we need a way. Yeah, there's no way currently that these systems can write something back that you see it in build service at the place where the package is working. what the results are, and packagers don't know what other tools exist around and who built something. So we really need to centralize this information. So for the future, we want to become better. First thing is the famous question, when finally build service will support direct to use Git trees. And we have some experimental code there, which no one yet fetched up and finished it. But we plan to have that that you are not limited to use OSC, our command line tool, or our API to upload sources. So what we want is that it's also possible that you can work with Git trees directly. And since we don't want to store a tarball each time a line is changing, we want to roll these tarballs then during build. So in the build process, before RPM build starts, we will have most likely some kinds of tools, which is creating the tarballs first. Has also again the advantage that people can bring their own tools. It doesn't matter if they are insecure. It runs in the VM, so they get the Git tree, it runs in the VM, they can do all kind of special things there, prepare the tarball, and then RPM build is starting. And what we also want to do is freeze. So the projects are a collection of multiple packages. OpenSUSE Factory is one project. And what we do a lot now is creating staging projects. So the OpenSUSE team decided that they want to bring Factory more to a status that it's more a rolling release than it's some random, luckily maybe working snapshot. They will work way more with these project links, so-called project links, so that the entire project is mirrored and then some package is injected, let's say X11 library, and the build service detects automatically that everything what is affected by this package gets rebuilt and then it can be compared. Unfortunately, the base is so fast moving, and when you need to fix something for a longer time frame, it moves away. So what we will have, and actually have already in an experimental state, is that you can freeze these revisions, that you stay on an old code base of the, for example, for the factory distribution, but it works with any other project. And you can modify it, and can do snapshotting via that. And of course, the QA support should be much better. So if we want to go into continuous delivery, we need to become much better in QA area. So all the problems I mentioned before, we want to tackle. We want that there are connections between the packages that we see actually when a test case in another package is failing after my change in my package. We want to integrate with GitHub better, so that when package is maintained on GitHub in future, maybe and a pull request comes, that we automatically can create packages and test cases again. Run the test cases. So we want really to make. If you don't want to replace the other frameworks, but we want to work with them together, and we want to bring the information together so that the packagers who work in their package and looking only at that, seeing the results of or the effects of their change. So I hope this was not too much text and you still have some questions. It could, I mean, okay, Michael and Florian obviously discussed it already, but then it was a RPM limited solution, and we maybe don't want to limit us to RPM, I'm not sure. I mean, the point about this is, What we always want to guarantee is when you have a binary RPM from the build service, that it must be possible to get the source of this package afterwards. So we want to store it in any case. And what's also a limitation is if it's inside of RPM, then it's inside of the secured VM build where you have no network. So I'm not sure how this should work. Yeah. Yeah. The thing what we have to face is with a public instance, everybody can go there and we need to protect us to some degree. And this is a problem usually most others don't have because it's only in-house, it's only for the company and the company trusts their workers. But if it's a public instance, it's a complete different story there. Yeah. And you want to back, you want to keep it if GitHub went down someday and we don't have our source code anymore, it would be a problem. Yeah, sure. That's what we plan to. Okay, another question? Yeah. I think it's in our internal build system. I'm not sure. Our QA department, they were talking about publishing them, but I'm not sure if this is happens soon. So. Yeah, the unit tests are, from my point of view, something in the packages itself, but the integration tests are test cases which uses multiple packages, but the most possible small amount, because what we want, of course, is fast turnaround times. I mean, it does not help if you make a one-liner change and you need to wait 3 days to build an entire new installation media just to check us. Then it's not really accepted and it's not used by developers. But when we can show that they get very fast feedback and that it's good to use the test cases within their work development style, then I hope we have more success in getting more test cases which do make sense and not just written there because they have to write something. Because it doesn't make sense to write just some test cases, it must really make sense to cover it. Code, yeah. No further questions? Yeah, we try to rule out that they are not reliable. I mean, the point is the build service is a very high level here, so that it's we don't want to go that deep into the code like Jenkins is doing with Java, because we see us more as a generic tool and a generic container above such a framework. If you have random results, then the QA system is not really there yet. We have some ways, but we need to talk about how to deal with random results if we can temporarily mark them and ignore them, yeah. There's still lots of discussion and design to do. What kind of images? Also, the question was about the imaging system in build service and if we plan to generate Docker images. The point is that the imaging system for build service is just another tool like RPM build. It's, in our case, it's Kiwi. And it should be easy to add functionality to generate Docker images to Kiwi. I'm not sure, but shouldn't be much of a problem. The build service won't notice. So it's